Today on the John Ankerberg Show, my guest is Anne Graham Lotz. She was called the best preacher in the family by her late father, Billy Graham. Anne is an international speaker and a best-selling author. When Anne lost her husband of 49 years, she felt both shock and intense grief. Then just a few years later, her beloved father, Billy Graham, passed away. And then 6 months after his funeral, Anne was diagnosed with breast cancer. Yet through it all, she relied on the constant companionship of the Holy Spirit to help her. We invite you to join us on this edition of the John Ankerberg Show to hear Anne explain how you can rely on the Holy Spirit to be your constant companion no matter what you are facing.
Welcome to our program. I'm John Ankerberg, and my guest today is Anne Graham Lotz, and we're talking about a topic that'll be especially interesting to those of you that are Christians. If you're a Christian couple and you're living together and you're constantly bickering, fighting, seems like nothing goes right, and you said you're sorry 100 times, but it just doesn't seem like it takes, okay? And you get discouraged. What hope is there for you? We're going to tell you there's a lot of hope for you, but we're talking about relying on the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to talk to some of you other Christians that have been hurt by Christians at church. People have lied about you. Or you have heard one thing at church and you said amen to that. But then you went out and you did things that you knew were wrong. And you've gotten away with it for a long time. God hasn't struck you down, lightning hasn't come out. What's going on? Can you get away with it forever? No, the fact is God's gonna step in somewhere along the line, but it may not be that way. It'll be taking the joy away from your life, maybe letting other hardships come in. God can be tough if he wants to be, but he's a loving God. Remember, the motive that he actually sent Jesus into the world is still John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's why God, he saved you if you ask Christ to come into your life. But if you're taking God for granted and doing things that you shouldn't do, that's what I want Anne to talk about today. Let's talk about, first of all, how much power the Holy Spirit has.
You know, who can measure his power, John? He is God. So all the power we think of being in God the Father, God the Son, is wrapped up in the person of the Holy Spirit. There's no limit to his power. There's no measure to his power. He's the same one who was in the beginning when God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, darkness was upon the face of the deep. It's the Holy Spirit that hovered over the face of the deep and prepared it to receive God's word and be transformed. So he's more powerful than we could ever estimate. It's interesting that the situations that you named, I thought, if I'm having trouble with my husband, I'm having trouble with my neighbor, I'm having trouble with my children, I'm having trouble with my boss, I'm having trouble with my church, I might want to see if the Holy Spirit's trying to show there's something in me. Because mm-hmm. I think sometimes he puts us in situations. And in fact, in the Old Testament, the meal offering was you take this fine flour that's been ground, mix it with oil, which represents the Holy Spirit, and that became the picture of the consecrated life. And they ground the fine flour by putting it in a round hole and then grinding it with a square pistol. And sometimes God the Holy Spirit puts us in a situation where we're with very incompatible people. And it can be within our home, our job, our church. But if we submit to the Holy Spirit, he will use that to refine us, just grind us right down, grind off those impatience, you know, the impatience, the lack of love, the bitterness, the unforgiveness, the whatever it might be, and he'll grind it down until when we surrender our lives to the Holy Spirit, then we become that picture of the consecrated life that is his aim. He doesn't want to just change us to change us. He wants us to be like Jesus. He wants us to fulfill God's purpose for our lives. He wants us to fulfill the potential that God has for us.
Yeah, his own disciples, he had quite a crowd, right, with his own disciples.
Yeah. That's right. And Peter is such a good example because Peter, you know, before Pentecost, he was so brash and brave and saying, Jesus, I'll die for you. And Jesus said, Peter, you know, this night you're going to deny me three times before the cock crows. Not me. I don't know what the other guys will do. I'll never do that. You know, so in the Garden of Gethsemane, he pulls out his sword to defend Jesus and cuts off the ear of the servant of the high priest and makes a mess. You know, Jesus told him, Satan is trying to use you. And then he went into the courtyard to watch the trials of Jesus, and a little servant girl came up and said, I think you're a disciple. No, I'm not. Somebody else came up and said, I think you are. No, I'm not. Third person came up and said, I think you're a disciple. You have a Galilean accent. And then he cursed, and he used the name of God to say, no, I don't know him. And at that point, the cock crowed, and he went out, and the Bible says he wept bitterly. But if you fast forward 50 days later, at Pentecost, Peter stood up, John, and the very crowd that had shouted,
Jesus,
crucify him, the very crowd that included some of the priests that had voted for his death, is some of the very crowd, the Roman soldiers that nailed him to the cross, Peter said, you have crucified the Lord of glory. You have just crucified your Messiah. And they said, what must we do to be saved? And he said, you repent of your sin and be baptized, and you can be forgiven and you can be saved. And they did, and they were. But the what I want you to see is the difference in Peter. You know, he was beaten for his faith, imprisoned for his faith. In the end, tradition says he was crucified upside down because of his identity with Jesus. He went from being somebody who was brash and, you know, so timid, actually, so afraid of the opinions of other people that he would deny knowing Jesus, to someone who was so bold in his faith that he actually gave his life for Jesus.
Right.
So if he can do that for Peter, he can do that for you and me. And I've seen that in my own life, actually. And because by nature, I'm very timid, I'm very shy, I'm a very private person. And he's put me out on platforms around the world. And I just pray that he'll take over and let him speak through me. Because one of the things I found is that we don't have to be able, we just have to be available. You know, so that if we make ourselves available to him, the Holy Spirit can fill us and use us and make our lives worth living. And I think I'm sure many of the people who are watching, life has lost its luster. Maybe it never had any. And they've had so much difficulty, so much suffering, so much persecution, so many curveballs, so many things that are thrown their way that have not been pleasant. But the Holy Spirit on the inside can give us joy that's not in our circumstances, that can give us hope that's based on what God's Word says, that can give us a reason to get out of bed every day and, you know, do whatever we have in our responsibilities and get up the next morning. And so the Holy Spirit can give us purpose and meaning and fill our emptiness. In fact, one of the verses I love, if I can read several chapters before, in John chapter 7, Jesus was at the Feast of Tabernacles, and he says in verse 37, he said, on the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture said, streams of living water will flow from within him. By this he meant the Spirit. And Jesus was telling us that when the Holy Spirit comes within us, he will fill us. John 10, Jesus called it abundant life, life that's full and free and worth living. And that's who the Holy Spirit, if we let him take over. And I was telling you earlier, the day after I got married, my husband and I were going to an airport to go on our honeymoon, and we ran out of gas. And so my husband, you know, being a big athlete, he locked the doors, rolled up the windows, trotted down the highway, but he left me beside a place that smelled like every sewer in the county emptied into it. So it was smelly, about 100 degrees outside the car. And 45 minutes later, he comes back. He's got the tow truck. They put gas in the car. Tow truck takes off. He goes to start the car, and the battery's dead. So he says, Ann, don't worry. I know where the gas station is. So he runs down. 30 minutes later, he comes back, and they jump the car and start the battery. And then just as we're getting ready to pull off, this car stops, slams on its brakes, backs up. All four doors open. It's his brother and some of the guys that had gone to the wedding. And his brother, who's an old bachelor, said, Danny said, how's married life? And Danny said, it's great, Sam, you ought to try it. And I thought, don't ask me. But what I learned the first day of marriage was that you can't run on empty. You can't run on empty in a car. You can't run on empty in a marriage. You can't run on empty in life. And I think there are many people going through the motions. You become mechanical about your faith, if you even have any. And you're just putting one foot in front of the other. You think that if you get more money, you think if you get a bigger house, you think if you get a different spouse, you think if you have, you know, more fashionable clothes, you think if your children are well-behaved and look good, you think if you get an education, that then you'll be fulfilled, but you won't be. It's none of those things will ever deeply, permanently satisfy you. It's the Holy Spirit that's that living water that satisfies the thirst deep down inside. And
yeah, how did you grow in the Holy Spirit? Yeah. Tell me what happened.
You know, it wasn't so much that I wanted to hear from the Holy Spirit, because I didn't know so much about Him even then. I was a young mother, three small children, small home, small sticky fingerprints, small, you know, all that is. And I felt very bound, and I wasn't coping well. And I remembered my mother with five of us. I never saw my mother lose her temper. What I did see is she spent a lot of time on her knees in prayer, and she spent a lot of time in God's Word, and I didn't have the discipline to do it and didn't know, you know, how to do it. I didn't have the time to do it anyway. But I wanted to be a better mother. That was my motivation, John. Mm-hmm. I wanted to be like my mother. And then God brought to my attention Bible study fellowship. I applied. I was turned down. I continued to pray about it. And so God spoke to me from Revelation, where He said, I know you have a little strength. You've never denied my name.
Right.
But I'm going to open a door for you that nobody can shut.
Mm-hmm.
I was so grateful He didn't say, "And you can do this if you just get out there, you know." But He said, "You have a little strength." He acknowledged every young mother only has a little strength, you know. And I had a little bit of education, a little bit of money, a little bit of time. But He said, "You just walk through the door." So, at that point, I reapplied for the class. The door opened, and found out that I would be the one who taught it, and that did scare me, because my own children didn't listen to me. I'd never taught anything before in my life, and. But when He said, "Ann, walk through the open door," then I had to make a decision. You know, either I would walk through the open door,
right,
or I would say, "No, Lord." And from that moment on, I couldn't call Him Lord, because it's been said He's either Lord of all or He's not Lord at all. And so I said, "Yes, sir." And the next verse, He said, "Hold on to what you have." So I said, "I know what I don't have. I don't have time. I don't have money. I don't have education. I don't have training." And He said, "And you have me, and you have my word, and you have the Holy Spirit." So you walk through the open door. So that's been over 40 years ago. I walked through that open door. I had 500 women in front of me from just about the first year. We had 300, then it morphed into 500, long waiting list. I taught it every week, never missed a class for 12 years. And then I went into the itinerant ministry and traveling the world.
Well, what I love is when you were teaching the class, you admitted you yourself were doing a crash dive into the scripture to teach the class. You didn't have all the answers.
That's right.
You went verse by verse. And the fact is, some of those verses are hard to understand. Yeah. And you had to crash burn hours to even teach the class.
I told them, "Don't ask me a question about next week's lesson, because I haven't studied that yet. You could just do one lesson at a time." They were great.
But I think that's a great word to all the people that are listening, is you might not have all the things you think that you need to have. Start where you're at, mm-hmm, and let God use His word to build in your life. Mm-hmm. In fact, I got a verse here from the Amplified Version. "We all, with unveiled face, mm-hmm, continually seeing as in a mirror the glory of the Lord," mm-hmm, we're looking at Him, mm-hmm, "are progressively," I like that word, not instantly, "progressively being transformed into His image," mm-hmm, into Jesus' image. Yeah. He's making you a small Jesus from one degree of glory to even more glory, mm-hmm, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you learn by reading the Word of God. When you talk to other women, okay, what do you tell them about the importance of reading God's Word every day?
You know, it's when I talk to anybody, John. It's not just women.
Yep.
You know, it's men, women, children, young people, old people. You have to read God's Word. And that verse that you quoted from Corinthians, when we behold Him, this is where we behold Him.
That's
it's
right.
In His Word that we see Jesus. You know, people who have visions and all that, and I say, "Well, God bless you," but sometimes those can be out of focus. This is where we see Jesus, and we see God in the face of Jesus. So we have to be in the Word if we want to know God, if we want to know Jesus. And And we have to surrender and yield our lives to the Holy Spirit. So it's a, when he says he'll change you from glory to glory, that's character to character to character. So he's increasingly molding you and making you into the image of Jesus. And one of the most critical things is that we surrender to him so that we allow him to fill us. Because when the Holy Spirit comes into me at my conversion, I have all of the Holy Spirit I'm ever going to have. So, you know, he's a living person. You don't get him in pieces. But he seems to get us in pieces. So we'll give him maybe Sunday morning when we're at church, maybe, you know, Wednesday night when we're in Bible study, or we give him, you know, public things but not private things. And you have to come to the point that you just give him everything. You give him access to your entire life and you ask him to fill you. And when you do that, the Bible says not to grieve him. You grieve the dear Holy Spirit when you hold out on him.
Which is a love word.
Yes. Yeah. When you resist him, when you neglect him, when you disobey him, then he's grieved by our sin because he wants God's best for us. You know, he wants us to fulfill that potential. He wants us to have the fullness of joy and blessing.
But what have you done when you've been reading God's word and you've been learning something and you come across something? I think in one of your books you had a list that you went through. And the first time you went through the list, the fact is you said, I don't think any of those sins, I'm committing any of those sins. Yeah. You read it the second time, and a few more popped out. Yeah. By the time you went through the list the third time, it seemed like there was something in every one of those sins. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, what do you do, Ann, when you realize, wow, this verse applies to me, and this is a tough one. What do you tell God?
Yes, sir. You just have to follow through and do it. You just, you know, if you hold out, if you hold back, if you refuse, then he'll bring the lesson some other way. He'll get firm with you, but you miss out on the blessing. So when I read my Bible, which I do every morning, apply it to my life, if there's something that I feel is specific that he's telling me to do or asking me not to do, I have to follow through, and I'll even write it down in a notebook to make sure that I hold myself accountable to that. So in our next session, if it's all right with you, I brought that list of sins that I could share, and because it was very convicting, and it showed me that I'd been a Christian, I'd been in ministry over 30 years at that point, and he showed me one sin in my life after another that I didn't know was there, and it just brought me to my knees and on my face in repentance. And then after that, I experienced what I think is real revival. It's an Isaiah 6 experience, actually, when Isaiah, remember, he looked up and he saw the Lord, and then he said, woe is me, I've seen the Lord. And then he repented and became the greatest of the Old Testament prophets.
What do you say to people that are trying to share Jesus with somebody, and that person does not want to listen and gives them a hard time? What do you suggest to them?
I suggest you pray.
Why?
And just because it's up to the Holy Spirit to convict them. That's what this passage says. John chapter 16, verse 8 says it's the Holy Spirit's responsibility to convict them of their sin, their need to get right with God, and judgment to come if they don't. So
that's
the wonderful thing,
terrific verse,
is that we can just love other people. We don't have to condemn them. We don't have to judge them. If they're children in our home, of course, we have to correct and discipline and train. But when it's somebody outside that, you know, we just love them, share the gospel with them, invite them to church, try to get them into a Bible study, but we don't have to correct them or make them good. We just love them as we pray for them and let the Holy Spirit change them. You know, one of the most wonderful freeing things as a believer is to know that God never commanded me to lead people to faith in Jesus. He never commanded me to be successful as a minister of the gospel. He just commands me to be faithful. Because it's the Holy Spirit's job, as I share God's word, as I pray, it's the Holy Spirit's responsibility to work on the inside of that person, convict them of their sin, their need to get right with God, judgment to come if they don't, and it's my responsibility to share with them at that point then what they do about that in order to get right with God and be filled with the Holy Spirit so they can come into the fullness of his blessing.
Do you have a prayer list?
Do I have a prayer list? Yes, doesn't everybody?
You think people should have a prayer list?
You know, if you don't have a prayer list, and some of the prayer lists are instinctive. You know, I start with my grandchildren, and that's after a period of worship, after a period of praise, after a period of confession. So I don't go right into intercession. But I start with my grandchildren, my children, their spouses, my staff, you as I'm looking forward to coming here. And, you know, so the, some of the prayer lists, you don't necessarily have to write it down, although it's a good discipline to do that, but just what comes to your mind. And I'll tell you what, when I read my Bible in the morning and pray, God can bring somebody to my mind, and I'll use one of my devices, my iPad or my phone. I'll just text that person, I'm praying for you this morning, and share the verse that I can't tell you how many times that's been God's word to that person for that day. It just popped up in my prayer time.
All right. I want you to pray with Christians that have given up. Maybe they've had hit a problem and they thought it was too tough. They couldn't get over it, okay? So they keep on sinning. And they need to restart their engine. They need to have God, the Holy Spirit, help them. And they need to ask for that help. Maybe they've got somebody in their life that is very close to them, but they're not a Christian, okay? And they've given up on them. They've been talking to them for years and years and years. Nothing's happened. I talked with a lady the other day. She says, I prayed for this guy for 30 years, and then he got saved. I thought, 30 years? And I'm saying, I want you to pray a prayer that Christians out there that have given up on the power of the Holy Spirit, that Scripture plainly states, that they can pray with you and they can ask God to recharge them, to refresh them, to forgive them, to help them with the problems that they're facing. Maybe they're in impossible situations that they think that there's no way out. Pray that God would give them that way out.
And what comes to my mind as you're saying that is somebody who may be an alcoholic. And I want to tell you something, that the Holy Spirit can come in and He can set you free from that addiction, but you may still crave it. So don't think because you still crave whatever it was that's been a habit for so long that that means the Holy Spirit's not working in your life. You just have to crucify that sin. You have to put it out of your life. And day after day, it's like the radiation I went through for cancer. I went through back and back. I had to go every day for a month. And the radiation every day worked on that cancer until hopefully, you know, it's broken it down and it's gone. So we come back and back to the cross every day. You say, God, I just crave that drink. I just feel like I have to have that drink, and bring it to the cross again and again. And He will increasingly break that craving, whether it's alcohol, whether it's an illicit relationship, whether it's dishonesty, whether it's addiction to something else, I don't know.
Drugs.
Drugs, of course. So let me pray for you, okay?
Yes.
So, Father, we come now and we thank You for the power of the Holy Spirit. And I'm praying right now that You would open the hearts and minds of those who are watching and listening to understand that Jesus in me is God the Holy Spirit. The same one who transformed planet Earth in Genesis chapter 1, the same one who lived in Jesus, the same one that raised Jesus from the dead, that same Holy Spirit lives in me and those who are listening who have received Him by faith to empower us to live a life of victory. We don't have to live in defeat. We don't have to live condemned by our sin and our guilt. So Lord, I ask, please, that the Holy Spirit, even at this moment, would make what we're talking about make sense, make it real, and as people reach out to You and once again surrender their lives to You, Holy Spirit, please, would You fill them with Yourself? Would You give them that assurance that they belong to You, that You've got this, You take charge, but they have to surrender everything to You in order for You to do that. So we commit them to You and the problems they're facing, the addictions that they're wrestling with, Lord, we commit it to You knowing that You're the one that sets us free. The Scripture says, where the Spirit of the Lord is Lord, there is freedom. So set us free, we ask, please, in Jesus' name and for His glory. Amen.
Folks, wasn't this terrific today? I think Ann spoke through the Holy Spirit to many of you as you listen. And I pray that you will follow through on what God spoke to you as you listen today. Thanks for joining us. Stay tuned. I've got a personal word for you in just a moment.
Stay tuned. John will be right back.
Thanks for joining me today. If you would like to have all 7 TV programs with Ann Graham Lotz entitled Relying on the Constant Companionship of the Holy Spirit, they are available on 2 DVDs for a gift of $88. In these programs, Ann describes the shock and grief of tragically losing her husband of 49 years. Then just a few years later, her beloved father passed away. 6 months later, Anne was diagnosed with breast cancer. And she explains how she would have never made it through these circumstances without the constant companionship of the Holy Spirit. Second, we're making available Anne's personal book entitled, Jesus in Me, Experiencing the Holy Spirit as a Constant Companion. If you love books that make you laugh out loud in one chapter and openly cry in the next, Anne does just that by sharing her own family's real-life stories with you. She tells about her own love story with the man that she married, and then wondered how she would ever raise godly children in our decadent culture, how the Holy Spirit helped her with a daily schedule that never quit and encouraged her when she encountered devastating disappointments. She reveals how she went about calming arguments between her children and sometimes between herself and her husband, how she taught her kids about dating, sex, and purity, and that life is hard and living for Jesus is not easy, yet the Holy Spirit is our constant companion. If you are facing these same kinds of issues, then you'll love this hardcover edition of Anne's book, and you will hear from God in every chapter. Now, we're making it available to you for a gift of $15. Finally, if you would like to have both her book plus all 7 TV programs on DVD, they are available together for a gift of $100. You may order them now by calling us at 1-800-805-3030. That's 1-800-805-3030. Or you may order these items at our website at jashow.org, where we have a secure place for you to give your gift. And if you live in Canada, you may order these items by calling us at 1-866-746-5803. And our Canadian website is jashow.ca.
Our goal is to present the evidence for the gospel worldwide and to encourage Christians in their walk with the Lord. This program is sponsored by the John Ankerberg Show Ministries and is made possible by the grace of God and your faithful prayers and gifts.